So welcome to the digital lecture series. I am Sanjay Bagade from the Department of Physics, Bajaj College of Science, Vardha. And the topic of our today's discussion is nuclear physics, which comes in the syllabus of the semester 5 of the undergraduate course. Whenever we talk of nuclear physics, the things that come to our mind are nuclear bombs, atom bombs, and all kind of destructive things. But it is not only about the atom bombs or nuclear bombs, but nuclear physics consists of particle accelerators, particle detectors, nuclear reactions, nuclear reactors, and radioactive decay processes. All these things go into making of nuclear physics. So in our first topic, that is particle accelerators, we will be taking a look at linear accelerators, which is also called LINAC. The first question arises, what is the need of a particle accelerator? I would like to explain this with a simple example. Suppose that a proton is made incident on a uranium-235 atom to carry out any nuclear reaction. Remember, a proton is nothing but an singly ionized hydrogen atom denoted by H positive ions. It is having positive charge, and a uranium-235 atom consists of 92 protons. So the situation is that a single proton is incident on an atom whose nucleus consists of 92 protons. So naturally, according to the simple laws of electrostatics, there should be repulsion between these two. The proton should never be able to reach the nucleus of uranium-235. But in order to carry out the nuclear reaction, there should be a collision between these two. How can this be done? The simple method is to increase the energy of proton to such a large value that it overcomes the repulsive force between itself and the nucleus of uranium-235, and it is then able to collide with the uranium-235 atom. So basically, to increase the energy of that proton, we require a particle accelerator. So in nuclear physics, particle accelerators are basically used to increase the energy of incident projectile so that it is able to collide with the target nuclei and the desired nuclear reaction takes place. So this is the simple arrangement of a linear accelerator, and it can be defined as a device which produces a highly energetic beam of positive particles as well as negative particles, and which can be obtained by proper application of AC voltage. The first linear accelerator was developed in the year 1927 by Rolf Widerow. The principle of linear accelerator is very simple. By using the drift tubes of suitable increasing length and by adjusting the frequency of radio frequency RF oscillator, the positive ion is made to gain energy in the gap between the electrodes, so that this process gets repeated many times. By application of a AC signal of a proper frequency, finally a highly energetic beam of positive ions can be obtained. So once more, we look into the construction of a linear accelerator. A linear accelerator consists of an evacuated metal cylinder, and inside this evacuated metal cylinder, a source of positive ion S is kept. The source emits positive ions, and with the help of a slit, a finely collimated beam of positive ions can be obtained. The linear accelerator also consists of drift tubes. So what are drift tubes? They are series of coaxial cylindrical tubes of increasing length which are separated by a small distance between them. These coaxial cylindrical tubes are called drift tubes. They also act as the electrodes. So all the odd number tubes 1, 3, 5, etc. they are connected to one terminal of the radio frequency AC voltage source, and the even number of tubes, they are connected to the other terminal of the RF oscillator or radio frequency AC voltage source. So during one half of AC signal, if the odd number tubes are positive, then the adjacent even number tubes, they will be negative. During the other half of AC signal, the polarity of the electrodes will be reversed. So working of linear accelerator, suppose that the RF oscillator is switched on and a positive ion is emitted by the positive ion source, and let initially the electrode C1 is negative. The positive ion, it faces an accelerating field, so it will be immediately accelerated towards C1. It enters C1 and begins to move with constant velocity inside it. Remember that the electric field exists only on the surface of electrode. Inside the hollow structure of the electrode, there is no electric field, so the electric field does not affect the motion or velocity of the charged particle. So the particle begins to move with a constant velocity inside the electrode. When the positive ion comes in the gap between electrode C1 and C2, the polarity of the electrodes changes. C1 becomes positive and C2 becomes negative. The positive ion once again faces an accelerating field, and therefore it is accelerated towards C2. In the gap between these two electrodes, it gains an energy equal to Q times capital V, where Q is the charge of positive ion and capital V is the applied AC voltage. Now when the positive ion gains energy, it begins to move with constant velocity inside the tube C2, and when it comes in the gap between C2 and C3, once again the polarity is reversed, so that C2 becomes positive and C3 becomes negative. Once again the positive ion faces an accelerating field, and therefore it again gains energy QV, so that its total energy now becomes twice QV. Remember that the positive ion, after passing through one electrode, its energy is QV. After passing through second electrode, its energy has become twice QV. After passing through every electrode in the gap, the positive ion gains energy QV. So after passing through n number of drift tubes, the energy of the positive ion should have increased by n times QV, where Q is the charge of the positive ion, V is the applied voltage. For continuous acceleration of the particle, the necessary condition that should be satisfied is that the time period small t required by the particle to travel along the length of electrode should be equal to half the time period capital T by 2 of the applied RF AC signal voltage. So t is equal to capital T by 2. It is equation 1. It represents the necessary condition for acceleration of the particle. But we know that the time period of the applied AC is equal to the reciprocal of frequency. So equation 1 takes the form T is equal to 1 by twice F, where F is the frequency of applied DC voltage. If Ln is the length of nth drift tube and Vn is the velocity of particle after coming out of the nth drift tube, then the time taken to travel through the nth drift tube is equal to T is equal to Ln upon Vn. That is our equation 3. So by using equation 2 and 3, we can write that the Ln is equal to Vn upon twice F. This gives the length of nth drift tube. So energy gained by the particle after passing through one electrode or one drift tube is equal to Q times V, where Q is the charge of the particle and V is the applied AC voltage. After passing through n number of drift tubes, energy of the particle will be n times QV. Now after coming out of the nth drift tube, the particle will have kinetic energy. And this kinetic energy is given by E. Kinetic energy E is equal to half m Vn square, where Vn is the velocity of particle after coming out of the nth drift tube. So both equation 5 and 6 represent the energy of the particle coming out of the nth drift tube. Equate them, and by making some rearrangement, we get the velocity of the particle Vn is equal to under root of twice Qn divided by m, which simply means Vn is proportional to under root of n, and n is here is the natural numbers. N is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4 and so on. Put this in equation number 4. So the length of nth drift tube is equal to 1 by twice F under root of twice n QV divided by m. So equation 8 gives the length of nth drift tube in the linear accelerator, and we see that the length of nth drift tube Ln is proportional to under root of n, where n is a natural number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on. Thus the length of drift tubes in a LINAC, they are in the ratio 1 is to under root of 2 is to under root of 3 is to under root of 4, that is equal to 2 and so on. And the length of the drift tubes are of increasing length. Now, so if the first drift tube is having the length 1 cm, the second drift tube will be root 2 times the length of first. So it is 1.41 times the first. The third drift tube will be root 3 times, that is 1.71 times of the first drift tube. And the fourth drift tube will be 2 times the first drift tube length. Thus, by using the drift tubes of increasing length and by proper AC voltage of proper frequency, a beam of positive ions can be accelerated, and thus a highly accelerated beam of positive ion can be obtained in a LINAC. The advantages of LINAC are highly energetic beam of charged particles can be obtained. Both positive and negatively charged particles can be accelerated in a LINAC. Disadvantage. We have seen that when the positive ion passes through one drift tube, its energy increases by QV. After passing through n number of drift tubes, its energy becomes n times QV. So if you want to increase the energy of the positive particles in a linear accelerator, we have to increase the number of drift tubes. Now, if the number of drift tubes are increased, which can be anything between 50, 100, 200 and so on, if the number of drift tube is increased, the dimensions of the linear accelerators become very large. The accelerator become very large and bulky. This is the disadvantage of linear accelerator. As an example, the longest linear accelerator in the world is SLAC, that is Stanford Linear Accelerator Center, situated in California in USA. It has a length of about 2 miles, that is nearly about 3.2 kilometers. So it is a huge dimension. Nevertheless, a linear accelerator can always be used to obtain highly energetic beam of charged particles, both positive as well as negative. So this is thus we come to the end of our first lecture. Have a nice day.